up a shout to adore you. Every sound that we make, it is for you. We will dance for your glory, Lord. We will dance for your glory. We will dance for your glory. We will dance for your glory, Lord. We will lift up a shout.
Hold up. we're saved. Jesus, Jesus, so let your name be lifted high as our grateful hearts now cry, Jesus. You ancient doors, the King is coming in. The King is coming in. We lift up a shout to shake the sky. Lift up a cry, be you glorified. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. Lift up your head, you ancient gates. Be lifted up. Shout to shake the sky, lift up a cry, be glorified. The King is coming in. The King is coming in.
Come on, go back into it. Come on. Come on. I think we're almost there, but we're not quite there. Come on. Come on. We're going to have church today. Amen. We're not going to settle for second best. We're going to go into the presence of the Almighty God and let Him have His way today. Come on. Every voice. Come on.
Lift up your heads, you ancient gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors. The King is coming in. The King is coming in.
He only comes in by invitation.
Shout to shake the sky. Lift up a cry, be glorified. The King is coming in. The King is coming in.
Lift up your heads, you ancient gates. Be lifted up.
Come on, let's hear your voice.
Ancient doors. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. We lift up a shout to shake the sky. Lift up a cry, be glorified. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. Lift up your head, you ancient.
Come on, I only hear her. Come on.
Lift it up, you ancient doors. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. We lift up a shout to shake the sky. Lift up a cry, be glorified. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. Lift up your head, you ancient gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. We lift up a shout to shake the sky. Lift up a cry.
Shout to shake the sky, lift up a cry, be glorified. The King is coming in. The King is coming in.
All right. Good morning. I want you to take a few minutes. I want you to go to the folks that are around you, introduce yourself, get to know to somebody. We got a lot of new folks. Go introduce yourself. Find out something new about them. Find out if they got skeletons in their closet. I don't care, but just go talk to somebody. Let them know you're glad that they are here and find out something about them. Introduce yourself. You might want to grab a mint first. If the person that talks to you needs a mint, let them know. Be a brother in Christ. No, I'm good. All right. Sit down. Good Lord. You act like you're Christians and love people or something. Y'all put on the Christian face real good. Good job. All right. Hey, give us some lights, please. Andrew, can you do that for us, please? Can you get the lights for me, please? All right. He just looked at me like, no. And I was like, Marcy, smack him. Good morning. Y'all glad to be in the house of the Lord? All right. Good to see some of you. I hadn't seen you in a while. I've been praying for you. I hope Satan's been buffeting you so you'll get back in church. Amen. All right. Destiny classes. April 10th, we're going to shift some things. That's coming. Not a lot of changes. We're just, where's my wife? April 10th is the night we're going to open up Gatesville, but the 17th is when we're going to switch to the new format, okay? We telling them that now or later? Later? Now? Now? Okay. What we're going to do is there's a lot of folks that didn't like that we went tonight. They wanted the morning. And then there's a lot of folks that didn't want the morning because they wanted a morning to sleep in. So we're a seeker-friendly church. That's funny. anyway, if you know anything about Destiny, and Destiny is a progression, you build. You have firm foundations, structure, development, enhancement, and refinement. We're going to do enhancement and refinement in one class on Sunday morning. We're also going to do a development class or structure Sunday morning. So you'll be able to do that. And then, so there will be two classes Sunday morning. And then in the evening, on Sunday evening, we will do one development class. And then the rest of Sunday evening will be life classes. It will be marriage, finances, addictions, and those type of things, parenting, stuff, life application, and fix crises in our lives or prepare. You know, we always want to go to marriage class when our marriage is messed up. Why don't we go to marriage class before and get prepared and equipped? Amen? All right. So we're going to do those on Sunday nights. Also, we'll do the intro, and we're going to bring back the gateway, which is doing the motivational gifts and the personality. Our heart is to try to get you plugged in and doing what God's called you to do. And so we'll do that on Sunday evening, find out what your heart is and try to get you to steer towards that and equipping you in that, okay? So help us out. We're going to have some of the classes we're not going to offer here anymore. It's only going to be through video or audio. Firm Foundations is going to be one of those. You may do that with pastors one-on-one, and then a couple other classes that will be just the video will be offered, and you do that on your own, okay? And then, but you still have to do each section before you go on to the next. But you can be in structure and be doing Firm Foundations. You can be in development and finishing up some stuff in structure. So trying to make it a little more convenient, a little more easy to get you through the process, amen? Because if you're just coming to church and listening to me, you're in trouble. Amen? You need to be digging your own. You should be confirming everything that is coming forth from here. You should be going home and studying. And if you're not understanding, not seeing, or seeing something different, you need to come and go to your elders and get them to show you. Or you may see something that we missed and correct us, which a lot of you think you can do that. But that's okay. We love you anyway. All right. What else with that? Anything else with that? What are you doing out of class? You're spoiled. We've got a picture of Ashlyn when she's about this age. She's in a little dress, and I pulled it down off the dress little cabinet or bookshelf that we have, and I put it side by side, and oh my goodness, they are just alike. All he needed to do is put a dress on him, and it would have been him. All right. Destiny Discovery, what else we got? Intro tonight. If you have not been to Intro to the Point and you would like to find out why I am the way I am, it's a long session and it takes too long, but we'll give you the brief cliff notes tonight. Amen? But we also will communicate what our vision is, what this church is about. And the most thing is we're going to talk to you about getting connected, whether it's here, whether it's down the street, whether it's wherever it's at. We believe wholeheartedly that everybody has a place that God has called them to, and we want you to get connected to that place. Amen? That was half-hearted. Okay, say amen. Amen. All right, every time, that's the way we need to do it. Yes, ma'am. If you are interested in going to Intro to the Point, please, you need to communicate that to Miss Lorinda, and she needs to make sure that she is talking to those that haven't. And if you're not answering the phone, stop it. Answer the phone. Answer the text. We want to get you connected. Amen? Is that what you wanted? All right. So see her right after or text her right now before the service starts, and let her know that you want to come. Because if nobody's coming, then I'm going to stay home on my couch. And actually, it won't be. I'll be doing something else. But anyway. I think we already have a couple coming anyway. So come join us, and let's have some pizza and have a good time. Amen? All right, look. Let's turn to your neighbor. Say, straighten up. He's looking up at Papa. All right. Okay. Couple things on that kind of stuff. Ashley just had her baby. Have y'all seen the? I know y'all. Is today the fast over on Facebook? Okay. Those that did not break the fast, like Billy and Michael Champion. It can go on Facebook now, and the heathens of the family, my sons, and you go back on Facebook, and then there's you can see beautiful pictures of our newest addition, Miss Nisi. What's the middle name? Nisi Shea. There she goes. She's already made a girl face, said Pastor Nat. I think she was pooping, is what she was doing. Okay. Y'all need Jesus. That needs to be on everything that we do. All right. So we need to. They have a big family. That's what. There's seven now. Eight. 15. What? How many in there? Six kids, two adults. So they need help. Being blessed. And so let's cook them meals this week. So can you see who we seeing? Miss Lorinda, stand up. If y'all don't know who the Miss Lorinda is, that's Miss Pastor Lorinda. Y'all see her and help cover a meal. If you don't cook or don't, Pastor Lorinda doesn't cook. You can buy them a gift certificate to somewhere and do that. All right. What else on that stuff, kind of stuff like that? Oh, Lauren, y'all stand up. This is for the wedding shower, right? Okay, I know that she looks like her daddy. I know. Y'all pray for her. And she looks white, but they're a Hispanic family. And we sent out invitations to the wedding shower, just the shower. And there's Mexico's population went down by 500 for that week. Y'all can sit down. There's a lot of folks coming to the shower, so we need help with food, and we need help with setting up and tearing down and all that, and we need you to see Miss Lindell. We need you to RSV as soon as possible because we might have to rent the expo center. we need finger foods, vegetable trays, fruit trays, chips, etc. Volunteers to decorate before and clean up after. please contact Lindell. Okay, Miss Lindell, stand up, please. All right. So let's bless our baby Lauren, as everybody calls her. I remember when she first came in, her mom told me she was like 9 or something like that. I said, that baby is not 9. She's 16 at least. But she was 9, and now she's getting married. And God is good. God is good. Amen. It took a long time to get that family saved. I did a lot of praying, a lot of fasting. I'm going to have a big old crown for that family right there. Well, not only because they were so hard, but it is a Hispanic family, so that's like 1 equals 5,000. So I got a big crown, a lot of jewels in that one, buddy. Amen. And then I had her sister first. That one was tough. Amen. All right. What else we got? What am I forgetting? Anything? Yeah. Well, yeah, it's your fault. I met Monica, was it in 89? 90. I know. Yeah. Did you hear? That's good. That's good. That was a good one. That's good. When did we meet? 90? 89? 89. When my baby was born. Wow. Long, long time ago. God is good. Amen. Am I forgetting anything? Probably you're right. All right, turn to your neighbor. Hey, guys, how y'all doing? Good to see y'all. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, I love you. All right, turn to your other neighbor and say, you, I'm trying. All right. Let's pray over offering real quick. So join hands. All right, dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. We just ask that you bless the offering. We just ask that you multiply. Father God, we're just asking that you would pay off this building, Father God, this year. I haven't asked that, Father, and I just come and I ask that it be paid off this year in Jesus' name. But Father, more importantly, I ask that we be obedient, that we bring our first fruits, that we bring our offerings, and then, Father God, in that obedience that you would pour out upon us. Father God, you would redeem all that you have given to us and protect it. And then, Father God, that you would pour out upon us. Open the heavens, open the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing that we cannot contain. Father, that we may use it not for our own gain, though we will have pleasures and enjoyment, but Father God, that we may further the kingdom, that we may go further and deeper in this city, that we may go further and deeper in this state, that we may go further and deeper in this country. And then, Father God, that we may go through to all the nations that you have called us to and influence all the nations of the world. Father, we love you. We praise you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Ushers, if you would come up here and stand for just a second while they're preparing. You can write a check to the Point Christian Fellowship. You can go online to the Community Point or any of the apps and give online. You can also give cash, and if you're going to write a check that's really huge, the Point Christian Fellowship and the payoff on the building is $250. So if you got $250,000, just write it. Amen? All right. What else we got? Who's doing Nugget? You are? Y'all are in trouble. Lorena's doing Nugget. Who's supposed to preach? You may not get to preach tonight. Okay, y'all ready? I'm gonna give her the mic. You just be ready because I may not get it back.
You taught me. Miss Amy, can you please put up my scripture? We're reading out of Exodus 17, starting at verse 8. While the people of Israel were still at Rephidim, I hope I'm saying that right, the warriors of Amalek attacked them. Moses commanded Joshua, "Choose some men to go out and fight the army of Amalek for us. Tomorrow I will stand at the top of the hill holding the staff of God in my hand." So Joshua did what Moses had commanded and fought the army of Amalek. Meanwhile, Moses, Aaron, and Hur climbed to the top of the nearby hill. As long as Moses held up the staff in his hand, the Israelites had the advantage. But whenever he dropped his hands, the Amalekites gained the advantage. Moses' arms soon became so tired, he could no longer hold them up. So Aaron and Hur found a stone for him to sit on. Then they stood on each side of Moses, holding up his hands. So his hands held steady until sunset. As a result, Joshua overwhelmed the army of Amalek in battle. After the victory, the Lord instructed Moses, "Write this down on a scroll as a permanent reminder and read it aloud to Joshua. I will erase the memory of Amalek from under heaven." Moses built an altar there and named it Yahweh Nisi, which means "The Lord is my banner." He said, "They have raised their fist against the Lord's throne. So now the Lord will be at war with Amalek generation after generation." I actually need you for just 1 second. The only reason is this scripture, if you'll stand here with your arms held high, face the worship team and lift your head. This was my first example of what it looked like physically as a man that raised his hands to the Lord, and also the exposure of his neck was the other thing that was my first example of completely surrendering. And James and Josh Driver, the next thing that I also noticed during my walk is, you stand here and you stand there, is that whenever I would see this man come to a place where he was getting tired and couldn't hold himself up, I watched the true men of God come alongside of him and hold his hands up. Okay, you can sit down. Okay? Now, for some of you that may, if you haven't had the experience with those kind of men in your life, I encourage you to continue to stay connected and get connected, because not only were they there to hold his hands up, I also, due to time, he also turned around, and when they needed their hands held, he also did the same thing. So there was a few things that I kept asking Lord. I was like, this scripture in 2006 was the first time that the Lord showed this to me, and Pastor Rick and Pastor Ned, as Miss Vivian, I believe it was Miss Vivian, that was praying over them in our little church. And I kept saying, "Lord, send somebody. And he said, "Well, will you go? Will you be the one that will stand next to him and help hold his hands high?" And I said, "Me? What do I have to offer?" So there's a couple things that I just want to point out. Israel represents the city of God, and Amalek represents the city of the world. Well, Rephidim is a place in the desert. It was dry. Woo, it was dry. They had no water. They had nothing. The Hebrew word for steady is translated emunah, which is the word of faith. It was Moses' steady faith in God's power that gave Israel the victory of the power of darkness, just as we lift up our faith in God's power demonstrated at the cross. Now, this is where I was kind of twisted, and I actually asked three of the men in my life. I couldn't get it this morning, and I kept asking him. I knew the right hand was of strength and power of authority, but that doggone left hand, I said, everything I keep finding about the left hand was weakness, and like people who are left-handed are sometimes considered wrong. They were taught wrong. They were backwards. My husband's left-handed. And a lot of people have ridiculed him because he's left-handed, because they're like, "Well, you do things different." But these two men spoke this to me, is although the left hand is everything that I found to be about weakness, it also represents the hidden things you don't see God doing. So Hur is liberty. Aaron is lofty, extended, exalted. And of course, Moses is drawn out. But we were drawn out to make a difference. We are drawn out to stand here. And whenever we get weary and we get tired and we need someone to come up underneath of us, we have to stand and lift our hands. So this is my challenge to you this morning. I don't know what's going on in your life. I don't know if your marriage was just as broken as mine was the day I set foot in this church, or if you were tired of being called a whore and you were ready to be called a Jesus freak. I don't know what it is for you. I don't know if your addiction has completely overcome you and you absolutely know that that's not where you want to get stuck at, but I challenge you this morning to just come and you lift your hands and you lift your face and you expose this area and allow the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and His Spirit to come and just know that you know that there are people that have been sent to help you raise your hands, but you have to lift your neck. You have to lift your face. You've got to do your part and just let Him have your way. So I ask you and I challenge you with that this morning. So give Him access. Give Him access.
Amen. Amen. Let's all stand. Let's bow our heads, please. Dear Heavenly Father, we desire to come into Your presence with all that we have. And Father, anyone beside us, anyone that is around us, Father God, that needs help to the altar, that needs help to Your presence, Father God, let us come beside them, left, to the left, to the right, and hold our brothers and sisters up, Father. We love You, we praise You, we give You all honor and all glory. And all God's people said, amen and amen. If you would, come on up to the front. Let's worship the King. Hit it, praise and worship. Tell somebody you love them. Tell them you're glad they're here today.
I've got a river. The Lord my God.
your glory as I fill the air with praise. Fill the air with your truth, O Jesus. Your kingdom reigns. Fill the air with your glory as I fill the air with praise. Fill the air with your truth, O Jesus. Your kingdom reigns. Fill the air with your glory as I fill the air with praise. Fill the air with your truth, O Jesus. Your kingdom reigns. Fill the air with your glory as I fill the air with praise. Fill the air with your truth, O Jesus. Your kingdom reigns. Fill the air with your glory as I fill the air with praise. Fill the air with your truth, O Jesus. Your kingdom reigns. Fill the air with your glory as I fill the air with praise. Fill the air with your truth, O Jesus. Your kingdom reigns. I pour out my life.
of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence.
Thank you.
God, dear Heavenly Father, let today, in this presence, in this time, Father God, experience your goodness and more of your presence. But Father God, let us do it more in the morning when we get up, as we're going to a work or school, as we're in that place that we're headed to. Father, let us experience more of your presence. Let us seek more your face. Let us seek more to have you capture us. Father, you are worthy of all praise and honor and glory. We say yes and amen to you. And all God's people said, amen. All right. Turn to your neighbor and tell them you love them. Tell them you're glad they are here today. Y'all give the worship team a hand. They did an awesome job this morning. Despite their handicap, the drummer. Someday he'll learn how to keep up with the beat. You want up or down, Rob? Up, all right. All right. Good morning. Are you glad to be in the house of the Lord? Yes? All right. I know y'all are busy talking to each other, but are you glad to be in the house of the Lord? All right. You got your stuff? You got to go get it. You got it? Okay. Quickly, I want two things before I introduce Brother Rob. On the 10th, we are having service at Gatesville at 5. Would love for you guys all to come out there as we open up that facility. So come join us. Amen. Amen. Yeah. Well, I'm glad y'all are excited about that. also, you know, we're talking about tithe and offering and believing God to bless us earlier. And this came to my mind as I was doing, as they were taking it up. Sunday, Thursday, I was preaching, and I mentioned that I wanted a BMW. And this person came up to me and said, if you got a BMW, what color would you want? And I said, black. And they just kind of like that. And then a couple hours later, they texted me and said, if you had a said white, I was going to give you mine. And I know you might think that's kind of bait and switch or whatever, but they were honest. That was what they had put before the Lord of what I wanted. It wasn't a matter of whether she would have done it. It was a matter of what I wanted and specifically what I was seeking. And she said, you can still have it if you want it. And I said, no, what you have put before the Lord is, was that what I stated? I don't want a white one. I want a black one. So I said, let me tell you what, I'll believe that it'll come through you and you'll keep yours. Amen? Amen. So we're standing in faith. And you say, well, why should you be believing that? Why shouldn't I? I'm not believing for just enough to get my bills paid. I'm not just believing enough to have a BMW. I'm believing enough that I can start giving out and I don't have to wait and say, Dad, can I get this? Can we get this for him? Can we get it? Can we get it? Can we get it? I want to begin to believe God for what things, so when they come to me, I already have it in hand. Amen? The other thing is that I wanted to point out is Lorinda, as she's talking about holding up our hands and holding up the arms, Lorinda and James are where they are today because they have completely surrendered unto the Lord, and they are people that will stand beside you and hold your arms up. And so I want you, as they are pastoring this church, I want you to get behind them. Yeah, look, I'm easy not to like. I understand that. But they are awesome people. You can love them. James is a little, but Lorinda's always in front, so you don't have to deal with him. So you guys get behind them and love them and help them grow this church, because our heart is that we will become a truly pastoral church, that we will have many pastors that can help the people, not just wine, not just make you feel good, but help you grow and establish and become what God's called you to be. Amen? So y'all rally around them. And I'm saying that because, yes, I won't be here all the time as I was, but I'm going to be here a lot. It's in capable hands. Amen? They are awesome. They love you very much. I've asked them often why, but they said because God made us. That's why. Amen? All right. Y'all love them. And behind now look, we got a treat for you today. We got elder, old man, old wise one, ancient of days, Rob Milliken. Y'all give him a hand.
I want to go to the scriptures first. It'll be a little bit lengthy, just more than we normally read. Lately, it seems like we've been doing that more, and that's a good thing, I think. But I'm just going to go to Luke 5. This is kind of an introduction because I need to lay a little bit of groundwork before I get to the heart of the message. And also before I get a little bit transparent with you about what happened last time Pastor Annette was up here. Let's go to the Word. So it was as a multitude pressed about him, Jesus, to hear the Word of God, that he stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two boats standing by the lake, but the fishermen had gone from them and were washing their nets. Then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and asked for him to put out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. When he had stopped speaking, he said to Simon, "Launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch." But Simon answered and said to him, "Master, we've toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net." And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their net was breaking. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish which they had taken. And also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will catch men." So when they had brought their boats to land, they forsook all and followed him. Lord, I just ask your blessing on the reading of your word. I ask, Lord, now that you would open our hearts to receive those things which you have for us today. And that as we leave this place, may we not just hold that word and gaze at it and look at it and inspect it, Lord, but that by your Spirit and his power, we would take it to heart and live by it. And this we pray in Christ's name. Amen. This is an incredible passage, and personally, I've got like three different teachings or sermons that come out of this passage. And today I'm adding a fourth. But it's going to be very brief out of this because I'm setting up what the Lord really put on my heart to say today. First off, I want us to kind of go back and just look at what was the result of this encounter with Christ, with Peter and Jesus. At the end of this encounter, it says that Peter and at least a few of the guys forsook all. When you read in other translations and you look at the Greek that's there, it's not that they forsook all. It is, but it's more than that. It's that they laid down their nets. They laid down their business. They walked away from their boat to follow Christ. A sold out life. Not really knowing what to expect. That's the result. Now, what is it about this man that came up on the shore and got into my boat and asked me to push out a little way from the land. And the next thing I know, I'm giving up my business. I'm moving from my family. The wife is at home. I'm following this man for the rest of my life. What happened? How did I get there? Could this happen today? Another question we might ask. Well, in Luke, we're not going to go in the scriptures to that place, but just the chapter before in Luke 4, about verse 38 is where it starts. Jesus left the synagogue and came to Simon's home. We don't know for sure that this happened right before the Lake of Gennesaret, but in the harmony of the Gospels, if you get one of those Bibles that puts all four Gospels line by line, they try to get it chronologically as in order as possible. Luke, in that kind of book that you look at, Luke 4 happens right before the Lake of Gennesaret experience. So here Simon had his home and Jesus comes. We don't know if he met him or saw him or heard him or why Jesus came to his house. I don't know. But he got invited to dinner apparently. So it said Simon's mother-in-law was suffering from a high fever. And they asked him to help her. So he stood over her. He rebuked the fever and it left her. And immediately they got up and waited on them. After dinner, there's probably some small talk, except I have a feeling that when Jesus is at dinner with you, the small talk isn't so small. But then right after that, apparently, he and the guys are out doing the family business, and they've toiled all night long with zero to see for all the trouble and the work, okay? So they're washing their nets. There's a story there that I can't go into. When they caught the fish, the nets began to break. That's an issue that we should look at, but not today. What really impressed me once more from this passage that I thought I knew so well was in the very first sentence. Can you bring up verse 5 again? Luke 5:1, verse 1 of chapter 5. Now it happened while the crowd was pressing around Jesus and listening to the word of God that he got in the boat. I'm going to take that thought for a second and jump over to something else. Give you a little bit of taste of where I was in my heart and my thoughts when God brought this to my attention. Last week we got a word through Pastor Nett that blew me away. Because I don't often get a rebuke from the pulpit like I did then and feel good about it. But she gave me a warning at the first and said, some of y'all are going to get mad. And I said, okay, brace yourself, Rob. I didn't think I'd be one of them. And I didn't really get mad. Really, my heart hurt. Because I realized I wasn't where I need to be. But I know Jesus is on the move. There is a heightened sense of expectancy about what's fixing to happen or what already is happening, and I just hadn't got in on it yet. That's what the deal really is. And so I got a rebuke and a correction and a challenge all in that message, and I took up on that. I got in on the deal, and I did what was asked of us, of me. Okay. Here's the thing, though. God came to me and gave me such a sense of where I am, not just me, but all of us, where we are. In fact, when I was trying to type this message a few weeks ago, back in October, actually, it's been a long time, I preached a message that said, do you know who you are? And I was talking about the spirit of Elijah coming to the church before the end, right? And that's going to happen. This one I wanted to call, do you know who we are? And what time it is. because what the Lord drilled into my heart was the fact that we're like this encounter at Lake Gennesaret in some ways. Jesus was there. He's here too. In this particular example, Jesus came on the shore. Here's Peter washing his nets. Obviously, from the passage before in the fourth chapter of Luke, I understand that Jesus has already met Jesus, has already sat at dinner with him, has been at his feet, as it were. He recognized that this was no ordinary person and no ordinary man, right? And so they're standing there on the edge of the lake, and it says specifically that the crowd was pressing him, but they were listening to the word. That's who we are. How long ago did we start the finishing season? 3 years, about? How long have we been pressing Jesus? But it's taken us this long for him to get in the boat. And when he asked Peter to push out a little way from the shore, and he did that, there was something that occurred even there. Even though Peter knew who Jesus was, he also knew that he was the son of a carpenter. And a carpenter's in my boat, and he wants to press out or press a little bit away from the land and begin to speak. So he sat down in the boat and taught. I would have loved to hear that, what he had to say from the boat. But at the end of that sermon, it's really interesting. It says that he told Peter, when he had finished speaking, he said, and this is in verse 4, put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch. Okay? So here's Peter. He has a choice to make. Am I going to do what he said or go? I'm tired. He told that to the Lord. He said, Master, we've been toiling, hard work, backbreaking, all night long and nothing to show for it. I'm going to let you as a carpenter tell me, a professional fisherman, how to fish? We know how to do church, y'all. We can do church if he doesn't show up. But we're blessed because he does keep coming over and over. He opens up the veil just a little bit to get a glimpse. Sometimes it's so heavy in here, you can't do anything but sink to your knees and get pressed into the carpet. And we're not the pros. He's the one. Peter understood this. And it's interesting what he called him. He said, when he gave his answer, he said, Master. So interesting. When you pick that word apart, basically there's two pieces to that word. It's epistata in the Greek. Epi is a preposition, and it means to superimpose or stand over. It's like if you have a picture, you superimpose another picture on top of it, okay? That's epi. And stata comes from a root word that I can't pronounce probably correctly, so I'm going to skip that part. But it means to stand. And so when he said epistata, we've been toiling all night, what he said was, Master, you are superimposed over me. You are standing over me. And I'm under you. And because he yielded and did what Jesus said, he almost sunk two boats with the fruit. It's really interesting to me. To me, I'm blessed, I guess. The Lord's given me an ability to go into the dictionary and pull out stuff and put two and two together, and maybe some ways that other people don't. And that's okay, but I enjoy that. It's kind of built into me. That's what I have to do. I don't have a choice. I got to do that, right? It's the way he built me. But the really interesting thing to me is that when I get a nugget, I think, wow, I understand. For the first time. I had never seen it that way. I understand. But I never thought about the fact that it's Holy Spirit of Christ in me that is superimposed over me standing. Amen. And I never get to understand until I've been overstood.
Amen. That's good.
And that's what happened to Peter that day.
Amen.
And he didn't understand fully anyway. Now, just think about the Gospels for a minute. Peter didn't have a clue what was coming. He didn't. But by faith, when Jesus said, follow me, forsake everything, lay your nets down, sell your boat, whatever. He didn't sell it because they had it later after Jesus was crucified. But anyway, you know, sell the family business. You and your partners are going to split. They'll stay. You come. Follow me, and you'll become fishers of men. He answered that call, and he stepped, left it, laying, needing repair. Because the nets almost broke. And he went, and they didn't even take time to count the fish, y'all. What businessman is there that won't count the profits, or at least what you get, you know, for a hard day's work? He left it. He walked away. And he began to follow Jesus, and look at the journey. Look at the trip that he took for the next three and a half years. My lands. If he hadn't taken that step of faith, he would have missed seeing the dead raised. Seeing the lepers healed. Seeing the transfiguration of Christ himself. He even got to see Elijah and Moses. Long gone. What a trip. What a journey. And then to end out his journey, he wouldn't have got to see that people healed by just him walking by and his shadow falling on them. And how that they took aprons or handkerchiefs or something from his body. Maybe that he'd been, when he preaches, he sweat. I don't know. But he gave those to somebody and they took them and people got healed. Just from the cloth that he had on his body with him. He didn't have a clue. But by faith, he took the step. And he cut ties and went with Jesus. Is that not where we are right now? How long have we been pressing? The crowd pressed Christ into this experience. I don't know that he would have gotten in the boat had they not been pressing him. How long have we been pressing him? How long have we been on our knees, on our faces sometimes, praying for the promise that's yet to come, yet to be seen? By faith, we have a substance of it now because we can taste it, we can smell it, we can almost see it. But until we press him harder, even to the point where for him to move, we have to cut off everything that we've been holding on to that doesn't belong in that new pattern, the new way that he wants to move, the new thing he wants to do. There's no room for some of my junk in the position and the place that he wants to take me with you. And that's really getting down to the heart of it. Because last week, after Annette's message, and she called the whole church to a fast. And then she went on to announce that next week we're going to have another full fast on Monday, but then a Daniel fast all the way up until Resurrection Sunday celebration. And there's a Good Friday service thrown in there too. That's going to be incredible. Amen. My expectation has been raised high. Amen. But I had to understand that what she's doing is calling the entire assembly to order. not just me. And so I want to help you understand that the prompting of the Lord in my heart gave me a picture that there are things that are coming that I can't walk into and I can't achieve, I can't attain, I can't get hold of unless we all go.
Amen. Exactly. Exactly.
In my younger days, I was a football player, tight end, kickoff team too. Did pretty good. Got my knee hurt, but that's all right. But as a football player, I couldn't be a football team. I couldn't be a company just because I had a position in a company that made money. I was a profitable employee, made a pretty good hand. But I couldn't be the company just as an individual. Just to break it down, we are in sore need, I think. Maybe not as sore as I'm thinking. Maybe it's not as bad as I think. But this morning I asked Pastor to have people mix a little bit and get maybe see somebody you didn't know that well, trade some information, get them to know them better, because I'm not sure we know each other that well here. And we're small. There are people here because of what I got going, and I can't mix like I should. And there are people here, I don't even know your name. I met a young man today, Andrew. Is it Andrew? Where are you? Can't see you. He's been here going here 3 months, and I still didn't know his name yet. But the Lord's called me to walk with him and you all into what he has prepared for us to go. And I can't do it if I don't have a sense of who we are. I know who I am, mostly. He peels back the layers on that too, but you know what I'm saying? I kind of got a handle on where I am and where I need to go. But I'm telling you that what's ahead of us, and we've been praying as a church, we're not going to walk into it unless we all go together. And that doesn't mean that we're all on the same level, but we're on the same page. And we're headed in the same direction. And there's a few things about the heart of this congregation that I need to bring to our attention. So some of y'all are going to be mad at me. If you want to send me email, it's okay. I can dump those pretty quickly. I'm not a Facebook person, so you can rant all you want to there. I don't care. I'm an individual. I'm going to back up before I start on that part, but I'm an individual. We need to recognize our corporate identity and who God has made us to be. There's more scripture that we could go into about how he makes a church or an assembly. You don't choose to come here. Did you know that?
Right. Amen.
If you're at all listening to him, he moves you here and plants you into the body, the local body, okay? And we're all different. Everybody has different body parts. Read 1 Corinthians chapter 12 in the first half of that chapter, and you can see how he does it. And it's important to understand that all of us are needed. Even the ones who seemingly, just by looking, you can't tell that they're even really making a difference there's a word, being engaged is one word that we use, engaging people in the work or just in the, you don't have to be in a position where you're doing a lot of work and people notice who you are. You're still needed. If you weren't needed, then you wouldn't be here. And just because you think you're not getting what you need, you can't bail and walk away either unless God tells you. That would be like my little finger on my right hand. I use my left hand finger to play. But my right hand little finger doesn't really do a whole lot. So since it's really not needed, why don't I just rip it off and throw it in the trash? That's the same thing as you leaving this place without the permission of God if you've been planted here. Amen? That's not in the notes. I'm going to get off of that rabbit trail, teaching about the body. But really, I'm an individual, And this time that I'm in right now, we are in, is called Kairos. That's a Greek word, Kairos. There's chronological order, chronos, where that's what your watch does. It marks the passage of time. But Kairos doesn't mark the passage of time. It marks the passage of events. It tells time by what happens. When you look back at your life, you can maybe remember a time when you didn't know the Lord. That's a Kairos time. It might last many decades. I don't know how old you were when you met the Lord. For me, I was about 9 years old. But then when I had that encounter with Christ and gave my life to Him and was reborn, I came to life for the full first time in the Spirit, because Holy Spirit came and joined with my spirit. That was a Kairos moment. That was an altar in my life, my salvation. There, since that time, there have been many encounters with God, many encounters with people, marriage, children. I mean, you name it. Deaths in the family, all of those are Kairos moments. You can watch the passage of time by what happened, the important events in your life. This is a Kairos moment. And many times I don't understand it's a Kairos moment until it's already gone, it's past. Right? And I can look back and say, wow, that was a big deal. I didn't even know at the time. Well, I'm here to tell you it's a big deal right now. If you don't know it, I'm telling you. Because for a long time we've been saying, God's fixing to open it up. He's fixing to do it. It's coming. It's coming. It's coming. And we press and press and press. We pray. We intercede. We do all the stuff. We're equipping people to be ready for the outpouring that's coming. I mean, this whole body is not even the same body that we were 3 years ago. There is such a depth and a level of maturity here, and now we've got other people coming for the first time, and we're beginning to see growth. We're beginning to see some things happen. We're adding on to another church. Right in the middle of all this busyness, God's fixing to drop us into something that we don't have a clue about. We're like Peter. I don't know what is going to happen, but I know it's going to be good. And I know it's going to stretch me, not to the breaking point. Well, it might. Do you know, before new growth can come, many times you have to break first before He can put you back together add a room. I don't know. Got to break through the wall. But I know that as an individual, I'm in a Kairos time. As part of this body, I understand that we are in the Kairos time. When we're not on the cusp of it happening, it already is happening. It's just that I haven't joined in yet. And I'll tell you right now, I don't want to be on the side of the road watching the procession on the holy road go by and me not be in it. What a loss. That would be terrible. We need to acknowledge that God is on the move and that and we need to get in on it. So that the choices, here's the deal, the choices we make and the actions we take need to be correctly established from a sober mind, an outlook that understands the gravity of the situation, earnest forethought of what the cost will be or may be, a positive intent. This is not going to come by accident. You have to step. You have to let down the net. It's an action, and it must be on purpose. There's an intent. It's positive intent. But also, when after the nets are down, the hard work begins. And so it's not just making the decision. It's a passionate, passionate involvement with that until it's complete. Amen? It's not going to be easy. That's where the glory is. I got a songwriter from way back. Y'all probably don't even know him, Wayne Watson. He put out a whole album about hardship in the Christian life. And he's talking about the high places in the snow-covered places that are hard to get to. And he says it's right there beyond easy reach. where the journey takes a little more faith, I guess. That's where the glory is. And that's what I've been praying for so long. Am I willing to pay the price to get the answer to my prayer? See, really, the price that I'm paying is not to buy glory. The price that I'm praying is to get closer to heart, God's heart, and to be in lockstep with Jesus so that when he lifts his foot, my foot lifts. And when he takes a big step, if it's bigger than I can manage, then I lean on him and he carries me there. But you got to want to go. Not only that, but there can't be any strings holding you back. Got to sever some stuff. Not just associations with other people, but even things in my own life that I need to cut off because they hamper. Maybe it's like a cloak. It says, lay aside all those things that weigh you down. That could be relationships, could be a job, could be my selfish interests. Those are the hardest ones to cut off because I'm denying myself. But isn't that what Jesus said? If you want to be my disciples, you pick up an instrument of death that's called a cross and you die on it daily. Die to self. Deny self. Die and follow me. And that's still the call for us today. I have to press into the realm of selfless devotion like I never have before. I must reserve nothing within myself or in my personal domain that's not dedicated to Jesus and fully under his control. Even the stuff that's not bad. I must make a determined decision to take hold of him in every facet that impacts my eternal life. Because really what the deal is, we live and die, 70, 80, 90 years, whatever. My dad's here today. He's 92. Been here a long time. It's seen a lot. The mercy of old age is you forget a lot of it, too. Because some of it you don't want to remember, really. But the thing about that is, that God isn't fashioning us for a lifetime here on earth. We think, man, if I could just make it before I die, if I can get this accomplished, that accomplished, if I can come to this level with him, then I'll have it made. No. It's a flash in the pan to him, this life. It's a wind that blows and then is gone. It's a flower that blooms and then fades and dies. It's only temporary. What this life is all about is getting what we need for him to fashion us for an eternity with him. That's where he's looking. He's not looking at this little pittance of time. It's not even a freckle on the timeline of eternity. He's fashioning us for eternity. And so I'm slow. Because I'm a little headstrong. You could ask Nona about that, but because I'm headstrong, I'm slow to respond many times, and it shouldn't be that way, but I have to wrestle myself. Do y'all do that? I have to allow the Lord to convict me, and then I go into a wrestling match. Sometimes it's with him, but most of the times it's with me, and I'm slow. If I'd be quick, I could have already been way down the road. So as an individual, there are some things meant for me that I can't have unless I change, allow him to change me. But also, there are some things meant for me that I can't have, that I can't attain by myself. And that's where the body comes in. We prepare individually to get ready to prepare corporately. Because until I get my act straight, I can't do what Jesus said needs to happen in the body. There's a new commandment he gave us in John 16:34, I think. Could you bring that up? 16:34 and 35. Is it Matthew, I think? I gave that to you, right? new commandment I give to you, this is Jesus, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all will know that you are my disciples if you have love one for another. All right, so I'm whittling. I'm letting God whittle on me. I'm letting Pastor whip on me, beat me over the head or whatever it takes, okay, to finally wrestle myself into a position where now I've given over to the Lord and I'm ready to advance. And so I graduate from me school and I go to us school. And now I'm confronted with his command here, his new commandment that says, you must love them like I have loved you. Well, how did Jesus love you? How did Jesus love me? He poured his life out. He suffered shame and disgrace. He was hung on a tree, which is a curse. He took my sin upon himself, not just to bear it. He became sin at the cross, according to what Scripture says. That's the model. So, I don't care who I choose to pick on. I'll choose my wife. I love her. We're married. We're in covenant relationship together. I have to love her like Jesus loved me. In fact, it actually says that about husbands. We're to love them, your wife, like Jesus loved the church. Well, it's the same way that he loved me individually. He poured his life out. Another interesting little tidbit that you don't think about because it's kind of tucked away in Scripture, but Paul confessed that the things that I'm suffering, I'm filling up the measure of Christ's suffering, and he's already in heaven. But his suffering isn't finished yet. He's suffering even while he's in heaven because he's also in us. And when we suffer, he suffers. And I'm filling up that measure, and someday when that measure basket is full, for all of us, he's coming back. But that's not what's going to bring him back. There's other things. That's a whole different message. But it's going to, funny how that's going to work out at the same exact moment. It's all going to be done all at the same time. Thousands of threads are going to come together in one knot. But I need to love my wife as Jesus loved me. So that means that I take no thought for myself. I speak the truth in love. We do that pretty good. We don't let each other get away with too much. We'll call it, but it's never done hatefully. It's done because I care too much about her to let her be in error. And so you just need to be more like me. That's not how it works. But see, we're not both eight personalities. And so when we butt heads, there aren't any sparks and fires that catch on in the room, you know, like probably at y'all's house, but that's okay. God knows all about that. He has a fire extinguisher in heaven that he can use to put out the fires. The realm of selfless devotion to him must be also applied in the corporate. I got to quit thinking about me because it's not about me. It's about the him that's in you and the him that's in you and the him that's in all of y'all. That's what it's about. And so when I get self out of the way, then I can start becoming what is needed in this hour to help bring this body together so that we can step out in sync. Sync, where we're synchronized with the Spirit of God, so that when he lifts his foot, we lift our foot. And we step in a new place, we are there. And there's places that I can't go and I can't be received. But if we go there, I'll guarantee there's somebody in here that can make the connection that I can't make. And that's how the kingdom of God gets bigger. That's how the rule and reign of Christ comes over a city and a region. And then even beyond that, the influence. See, as an individual, I don't have much influence or impact on this fallen world. Just a little. Because I don't know everybody. But when you get a body together, you can reach thousands. In fact, it may not even be confined to this city or this state, but around the world. I already know that. I've seen it happen. Together we can go places I can't go by myself. Together we can touch people with whom I have no access. Together we can do mighty exploits in the name of our Lord that I can't do by myself or on my own, even with Jesus. Together we can step into a realm of unimagined glory and power that I might never experience on my individual journey traveling alone. And I believe that is exactly why we haven't already made a breakthrough. Because we're not on the same page. We're not pointed in the same direction. We don't have the burden to go as a group. And part of it is because we don't know who we are as Point Fellowship. The Point Christian Fellowship. So we need to start working on that. We have to gain an understanding from the one who stands over us. He stands over us to grant us revelation that we can understand where he is and what's going on. A deeper appreciation of who we are together, because if we don't have that, then we will not be able to advance into the new realm that he's unfolding even now. I already talked about one of the characteristics that we have to put on or assume to take on ourselves, and that's love. Love each other. Look at 1 Corinthians 12, verse 24 through 27. Talking about the different parts of the body, all of them aren't presentable, right? Our presentable parts have no need of honor from us. They get honor because of what they're about and what God's doing in them, and they get noticed, and you know, people appreciate the effort. What about all the ones that are behind the scenes that never get noticed and never get any credit for anything? The people that clean the toilets, the people that change the trash bags, the people that serve at the serving line at a function or whatever. They're just as important as anyone. I mean, we wouldn't be eating. We'd have full trash cans, and you wouldn't want to go in the toilet if it wasn't for them. God composed the body, having given greater. Excuse me, you got to go back. Go back to that previous verse, please. Yeah. God composed the body, having given greater honor to that part which lacks honor. So if they're not noticed, they need to thank you for me. They need to clap on the shoulder, a hug, and say, you know, I really appreciate your ministry. And they look at you like, what ministry? What are you talking about? I don't minister in this place. Yeah, you do. You minister to me and my wife and my family and people. You minister to everyone in this whole place. It's just that you don't get recognized for it. And I want to give you honor here. Thank you. How about coming over for a steak? Besides that, there's a really important commodity, if you want to call it that, that comes in a body that's operating correctly. It's called unity. And we can try all kinds of different things to make unity in the body, but it's not going to really work very well, maybe for a few moments or a day or two, and then it'll go away. The reason is because unity is actually a byproduct. And I'll tell you why. What's the first and greatest commandment? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. What's the second? Love your neighbor as yourself. Or a new commandment I give to you, you love one another like I have loved you. If we do those two, and they have to be in order, you got to love him first, because if you don't and give your life to him, you don't have the capacity to love each other. There's nothing in you. I mean, you might like them and you might pal around for a while, but you won't lay down your life for them until you've been converted and changed in your heart with the one that should be number one on your list. First, second, then unity. Because without the love, Jesus said it. By all this, all men, pagans, unsaved, atheists, those people that only believe in there is a God, all they have to do is look at you and us and this church and see something that's supernatural. This isn't normal. I've never seen this kind of care for one another. They're so different. They have nothing in common. How can they lay down their lives like that for each other? Must be a God. It really must be a God. Not only that, but they're loving on me. I hate it. But it's melting my heart. Unity. It's a byproduct of the obedience to God to love Him first with everything we got, and then to love each other second with everything we got. Then when unity comes, you protect it. You nurture it like newborn life. You don't leave a new baby out in the field. You protect it. You feed it. You nurture it. You stroke it. I mean, that's what we do in here. We should be stroking on each other. Not facetiously. You know, a flirt, when you flirt someone, or the other word, that's not the word I was looking for. When you, what's the word when you build somebody up and you don't really mean it? Flatter. Thank you. I knew it was something like that, but it wasn't coming. Flattery is hollow because it's not really, it's not heartfelt. You'll say some great things about someone, but then you can turn around and the next person, you cut them to shreds. So we're not talking about flattery. We're talking about genuine care. In fact, in 1 Corinthians, it says right after this part that if one member stubs their toe, then we all hurt with them. That's how much we need to feel each other's pain or their, you know, whatever's going on. But at the same time, if someone else is honored from outside, if they get a promotion at work, we need to all celebrate. Not just the good fortune, but the value that's in that person that earned that promotion. Amen? And that's the way it ought to work. Unity in the body. We'll be less effective in the next realm if we're not unified. In fact, there's doubt that we could even bring anything of value to come at all. Because you can have church without the presence. You can do church wrong. And I won't even go there. That's a whole nother message that I have on that issue. All right, so how do you get this unity in the body? You love God first and love each other like He said in the pattern of Christ. But then also there's a passion that must come with that, a passion for intimate devotional life with Jesus. The world has taken passion and perverted it. They call it Easter, the crucifixion on the hill, Christ's passion. Why? I thought passion was something that just made you feel, you know, just ooze stuff and make your juices juice, and where you just can't, you know, you got to draw near and you got to love and hug them and buy them stuff. And all. Isn't that passion? Isn't that what passion is in the world? Well, what, that's not the cross, is it? No, not that model. But again, if we really understood the crucifixion of Christ, why did He come here? To buy back a race that's totally separated from God for eternity. It's lost. Come to think of it, the person that you know at work that's lost is a big deal to God, because from His point of view, if I lose that one, he's gone forever. To me, I don't really give a rip. I don't care. He's nasty to me. He stole my stuff. You know, he got a promotion instead of me. He lied and backstabbed. I got demoted. I mean, that's the kind of stuff we look at. That's not what God sees. All He's doing is acting dark. That's who He is. He lives in the dark. He's unborn. But me, I got the light. And if I can't show the light to Him, even though He's treated me bad, then I'm failing. Come to think of it, that's why the United States is in the shape it is today. It's not the fault of the idiots out there. It's the fault of us, because we're not being the light and the salt. And when God begins to judge, we're already under judgment as a nation. I hope y'all know that. But when it really begins to pour out, where do you think it's going to start? In the White House? In Congress? It's going to start in the church. because we're the ones responsible. Told you he's going to get mad at me. Think about it. They can't act any way but who they are. What about you? Can you act any way other than who you are? Yes. I'm the light of the world. But sometimes I hide it under a bushel, or try to. I can hide it for a little while just to get by, so I don't have to have a stern face while everyone else laughing at a nasty joke or cursing or whatever the issue is. I can hide my light for a minute, just enough to get out of there. When really what's needed is to bring that light into that darkness. That's a whole other story, y'all. We need a disciplined walk, not just individually, but as a whole church. Because if we're going to walk together, it needs to be under control. If we're walking in opposite directions, we're not going to get very far. If we're walking in diverging paths, we're going to get split, and that's definitely not on God's agenda. I mean, it's different than calving, okay? When you have a baby, that's a good thing. You've calved. You made a new me or whatever, a new us, right? A new us. So Gatesville is getting a new us. It won't be exactly the same as us, but that's okay. God's in the business. See, I can't go there. It takes too long. Gatesville will not look exactly like us because the needs in that city are different than they are here. But we have to walk together, and for that, all of us need to be disciplined individually, and we need to learn how to walk together as a group under the headship of a senior pastors and associate pastors. All this backbiting that happens that I don't ever know about because I'm not in the loop on that, but they are. They get it all. Backbiting, speaking out, oh, I hate the way they do that. All that's got to quit. Those are strings that are ropes, chains that are holding us back from together walking into the promise of God. We can't do it. We got to get disciplined. So when the word says, does not say, think happy thoughts. See, that's the world's counterfeit of what God really said. Positive thinking. No. Put your mind on heavenly things. Is there a difference between that and what? Yeah, oh yeah. Night and day difference. Discipline. Discipline. I'm going to get off of this, go to the last point. But if I discipline this body and keep it in order, then I'm listening to the same spirit at the same time that you are. And that creates unity in itself. Because what I hear, you're liable to have already heard, or we hear it at the same time. That happens in this place often. When you have speakers come up here, and at the same time in Alabama or California or wherever, the same message is being delivered almost to the T. Well, that's no accident. Wow, what a coincidence. Well, you're right. The incidents happen at the same time, so technically that is a coincidence. But it's the divine design above that that we ought to be looking at. It was the same spirit saying the same thing. Amen? That's what's needed in a unified body that has power and that has purpose and knows where we're going. It's like, who are you, who are we, and what time is it? Time is to get off our backsides, put our nose back to the grindstone. If you're already weary and tired of that, pray for the Spirit to come and give you a fresh wind. He is the wind. One last thing, and then I'm done. In a unified body, we need to understand and have a Christian worldview. Because God is so much bigger than our little microcosm that we have here. And for us to expand our understanding and that, we need to be paying attention to what he's doing all around the whole world. One thing that I could say about that issue, the Lord one time helped me understand that the population of Earth is getting so huge, and that Christianity in the world is seems to be as small as it ever was, down to just a few percent, right? And even in the United States, I think the experts are saying, I thought it was 6, but now they've lowered it to 4%. And all of the people that are named by Christ aren't Christian. They wear the name, they wear the gold cross, but it doesn't mean anything, because the presence of God never shows up in their house or their church. I'm not saying that to brag about our place, because you know it's different here. The issue really is, I should be on my face weeping, because now it's coming down to it where this whole nation isn't going to be the same in another 5 or 10 years. Won't be anything like I used to know. And I need to be weeping and doing something about that to slow it down or something. But it's all in God's timing anyway. But the real issue is I need to pay attention to what's going on around the world. Even with a small percentage of Christians in the whole earth, the Holy Spirit is on the move. And he's displaying more power today than he did at creation. That's hard to say. Maybe not creation. That was huge. Think about Pentecost. What about Pentecost when the Holy Spirit came to tabernacle in us? How big an influence, how many people were involved in that? Well, first there were 120 from the upper room, and then there was 3,000 that got saved, and then another 5,000 later, and then it started going to house churches. It started expanding pretty quickly. But do you understand that right now, with the millions and millions of Spirit-filled Christians around the earth, God is pouring out more power now than he has from Pentecost until today. There have been more people alive on this earth. There are more people alive on this earth right now today than all of the ones who have ever lived since the Garden of Eden, if you add them all together. That's the scope of what God's doing. Do you have a worldview that encompasses that? About what's on his agenda worldwide that we're supposed to be involved in? So who are we? What time is it? It's past time for us to move in, but we got to get our heads on straight. It's not our heads, it's our hearts. We got to get our hearts positioned to go with God into this new, and that's what the Lord hammered me with in your message. There are certain things I need to do individually, but the truth of it is, the thing that I've been pushing for and pushing for and pushing for isn't going to come because I'm pushing. It's because we're pushing together, and I won't see it unless we go together. Because the influence, the impact, the power that's unleashed is bigger than me. It's really bigger than us. But it's going to take us to see that day. So I'm hoping and praying that the Lord will now infect you with the vision that he got my attention with, in that we got to become a real body here. You just can't call us an assembly anymore. We got to work like a body. And the heartbeat is the Holy Spirit, I guess. The head is Christ. And if we're not all connected to the heart, then we're dying. Or maybe already dead. I don't know. Just an appendage that's kind of hanging there, all black and shriveled up, and it stinks because it's not connected to the blood flow. Does that make sense? We need to pay attention. You need to step back and take a look. How am I connected here? How can it be that after 3 months I didn't already know that guy's name, wherever you are in this place? That's crazy. He's part of my body. I need to work at it. It's not something that's going to come serendipity, just as an accident, an added blessing because I showed up. No. I got to work at it. I got to make it happen. And so do you. Amen? Amen. Y'all stand together. All right, so here's a test. Y'all didn't know there was a test with this, right? The call's already been made. There's going to be a fast starting tomorrow, whether you start it at 6 o'clock tonight, like the Jewish day starts, or if you wait till in the morning before you go to work or school or whatever you do. There's a fast, a full fast, water fast. But then after that, there's a Daniel fast, which if you don't know what that is, you can call some of the leadership or look it up yourself. Pardon? It's online? Okay, it's online, so you can read about what it is. Question is, as a body, are we going to do that together? I didn't even try to ask who did and who didn't last week, because this is a new day, right? I don't have to feel sorry for what happened last week or last Monday. I'm talking about right now. Right. You have a choice. Are we going to enter into this together or not? Are you going to be part of the parade on the highway of holiness, the entourage? Or are you going to be standing on the sidelines watching it go by? Don't miss it. Don't miss it. Because we're not going to get to the thing that we've been working, pressing, and crying for and interceding for the last 3 years is God already opened the door. The river's already flowing. Question is, are we as a body going to enter in? And not only that, I'm thinking about the prophets of the whole church here. The prophets didn't say, do you want to get in? He said, how deep do you want to go? You're just going to dabble in the shallows? Or are you going to push out into the deep for a catch? Don't miss it. Father, in Jesus' name, I speak blessing over our body. For those who hadn't been here very long, Lord, you can move them to the very center overnight of what's going on here. All we have to say is yes to your call. And so, Father, in Jesus' name, I speak a blessing over the body. But, Lord, I ask that your spirit would not even let us sit down and lay down and rest until we have made a decision to go 100% full-fledged, full speed, not even knowing what's on the other side of this wall, Lord, but we want to break through. We want to break into the glory. We want to break into your presence like we've never known. It's already good here, Lord. Don't let us settle for good. Do not let us settle for good, but we want the best. We want it all. And so, Father, by the power of your Spirit, the unction of your Spirit in us, let us move forward in faith together into your glory to run on the heights with you as a body, not just as individuals. This I pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Y'all give him a hand. Mike, quickly, I want you to think about something. What does your day consist of? What is it consumed with? I want you to be truly and totally honest with yourself. Nobody else is going to look over your shoulder and cheat and see your notes. This is only in your mind. If you have problems going, things in your mind, and it's kind of clouded in there, we'll pray that clarity come. But if you have to write it down, go write it down at home. But I want you to realize, think about, understand what you do all day long. What are you consumed with? Are you consumed with perversion? Are you consumed with the kids? Are you consumed with the grandkids? Are you consumed with getting a car, with a job? What are you consumed with? What does your whole day think about? Is it the shows? Is it the TV shows? What is your day consumed with? And as Pastor Elder Rob was preaching, I'm thinking, Rob, God spoke to you. This is for the group of people that have understanding of what's going on and moving the church forward. And I got rebuked by the Lord and says, no, this is for the people that need to wake up. They need to move forward and they need to come into what God's called them to be. Because, see, the thing is that we are consumed and we don't think anything's going to happen. We don't think anything's going to change. We're just going to do our socially good thing. We're going to come to church. We're going to try to be good, and we're going to move forward. But let me tell you something. Being good is not going to get you into heaven, and heaven is not the destination. Being in Christ is the destination, and I'm challenging you. I'm not rebuking you. I'm not trying to beat you up. I'm not trying to expose you. I don't even want to know what you think, but I want you to look at your life, and what is it consumed about? Can you put up Matthew 10:28? Because we do not preach this anymore. We've preached a socially acceptable gospel, and we have preached a feel-good message, and we have done everything to edify you and lift you up and exhort you and make you feel good in the churches of America today. But I want you to see something that we do not look at anymore. And fear not them that which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body. And that's not reverently fear the Lord. That word is fear, run, be afraid of, be scared. And we are not afraid of God because he's good, he's gracious. He's this little cherub thing with the little wings and a little baby face, and he's going to be, everything's going to be okay. But there's a hell to shun, there's a hell to walk away from, and there's a place to go, and the promise is God is good, he's awesome, he's beautiful. But you're called to more than the ball game, the school, the job, the car, the house, the fishing, the golfing, all of those things. Those are all byproducts of a life, of abundant life that he has for us. But first and foremost needs to be God. And if he's not, every morning when you get up in the morning and throughout the day when you go to bed at night, I want you to seriously pick up a Bible and search out and see what he says. Because you are more than that. You are more than those things. You are called to bring people to him. And him should consume you. And when him consumes you, bringing people to him is easy. Amen? Amen. Look, I'm not trying to condemn you. I'm trying to be, let's be real. Because I get, you know what is the worst thing? You know, you guys all look, we can go look at each one of you, and some of you got some bad stuff in you that you think about all day long, about how cute he is or how, you know what's the worst thing? Is to think about how to build a church all day long and never think about the church, the person that you're building the church for. I can be so consumed with making this grow that I don't think about the king himself. Amen? So my challenge is today, he's saying, look, know who you are and know what we are and know your vital role. That scripture that he said that he gives honor to those that lack honor, what he's saying is, the other portion of that is you who do not have a mic, do not have a voice to speak to the whole crowd. He's saying, God says you're more honorable and more important to the body than we are up here. Amen? You are vital to make this grow and make this expand. Not to for the point to get bigger, but for Jesus Christ's body to get bigger. That's his motive, because he could care less about the point and Ricky Donaldson and the scope of things and the leadership of here. He's worried about you touching at the golf course, at the ball game, at the work, at the thing, all those places that you go to. He's worried about you expressing that love that you receive from him to someone else to bring him into the kingdom. That should consume you all day long. Amen? All right. Yes, dear.
First, I just want to say thank you, because Rob preached my Sunday school message this morning. It was all about the corporate body and how we are individually but corporately. We all stunned that you were in class. I was like, what the what? Every single scripture, it was redonkulous. I mean, seriously, it was redonkulous. So I'm like, thank you, Jesus. That's a major, huge confirmation. I mean, how that was stupid. I was getting slapped over there. But the reason that's so important is because the word all day today is that we're one body. We are one body. And I wanted to just explain to you the reason for the fast. And if you don't know what a Daniel fast is, you can go to the book of Daniel. It's in there twice. You can read it, or you can go to the media on the website is the audio of the last fasting class that I did that you can listen to, okay? Part 2 explains the Daniel fast. But This is a week that we want to walk in self-denial. Jesus denied himself to do the will of the Father for you and I. And the reason that I feel like, besides removing the old wineskin so that we can become a new wineskin, so that the Holy Spirit can pour the new wine into us so we can carry it, the reason we're doing this is for two reasons. One, we want to steward the word that God has given. If God releases a prophetic word and we just stand around and wait for it to fall out of the sky and hit us, we are never going to achieve what he's given for us to have. It's a choice we have to make. So fasting is stewarding what God has given us. And fasting also for this week is to say, you know what, we are going to deny ourselves the things that we love when we're eating. And we're not going to starve because you still get to eat, hallelujah, but you don't get to eat all the stuff that you want to eat. So I won't have any steak. I'll be sad, but it'll be okay. So, but the reason being is because when we come in here on Good Friday, when we really, I want our hearts prepared to really be in a place of tenderness and devotion before the Lord when we consider what he did for us. It's not going to be a normal Good Friday thing for us. We're going to worship Jesus. We're going to have communion together as a body. We're going to break the bread. We're going to drink the cup together. We're going to remember what he did with our hearts already conditioned with self-denial for days. And then when we come in here on Resurrection Sunday, we're going to have a freaking party. We are going to have the best time in the Holy Spirit. I'm telling you what. Don't wear high heels and just be prepared to sweat, okay? Because we're going to have a high time. The feast times with Jesus are a high time. There's not going to be no sobbing and bawling and crying. It's going to be rejoicing because Jesus is alive. And no more self-denial. Do you know what I mean? It's accomplished. The curse has been broken. We've been redeemed. It's going to be a party. So that's what this week is all about. It's about remembering that he died for us, and we deny ourselves. And as we're fasting, we're looking to him, and we're speaking to him, and our devotional time should be increasing. Our times in the word should be increasing. We should be so, Wednesday night should be so, it should be tangible in here when we come together. It's going to be amazing. Our hearts are linked together. When you hurt, I should hurt. When you're rejoicing, I should rejoice. When you're wounded, my supply should heal. And that's what we're going to get together corporately and do this and join our hearts. And at the same time, we're going to join our hearts with Jesus. Amen. So with that awesomeness, we actually have membership today. We have people that want to join. We have new members. We are not members of the body. So are there, Jennifer?
So those that want to join, come on up here. Get right here.
Yay. If anybody else wants to join who hasn't said, the young come up now. It's all good in the hood. Yay, this is Jennifer and Wayne. She's awesome.
Okay, pastors and elders, get around them, and deacons, and then the rest of the body around
Jeannie's
them.
Jeannie's coming back.
Jeannie's Yay! Coming back in.
We always claimed her, even though she left, but that's
even though she was a prodigal son. Okay, members, come on, let's get around them. I know it's almost 1. I know y'all are freaking out. We've got to eat. We've got to hurry up before 6 o'clock. Get everything in. All right. You guys ready? All right. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you. Lord, your word declares that you place members within the body. And so, Father God, first we say thank you. We thank you that you chose us. And we thank you for these gifts that you've given us today, Father God. And we just ask, Father, as they have stepped in obedience and they've said yes to you, Father, we just ask for you to pour out your blessing upon them. We ask, Father God, that you would open the heavens and that you would pour upon them, Father, and cause them to prosper in all their business and prosper in all that they lay their hands to. Cause them to prosper in their dreams and prosper in their calls, Father God, that their families would come together. Just cause a refreshing and a renewing. Father God, all the word and all that they have been taught that would be come alive, Father God. Stuff that's being dormant, Father God, would be made alive, Father God. And we just ask for a fresh word and a fresh anointing. We ask, Father God, that you would lay on their hearts their call, that they would become clear and recognize it. And then we ask that the leadership, Father God, would see that as well. And then, Father, help us that our leaders to equip, the fivefold ministry, to equip them in the ministry into what they're called to do, Father God, to come alongside, exhort, correct, discipline, and teach, and Father God, encourage, and come along and lay down our lives together with them, Father God, to empower them to further the kingdom, but most importantly, to teach them to be face-to-face with you, mouth-to-mouth, breathing life into them. Father God, as you bless them, just cause them to multiply in all that they do, Father. We thank you for it, and we praise you for it. Now, Father God, as we make a commitment to them as a body, that we'll lay down our lives, Father, in body, soul, and spirit, that we ask they do the same, Father God, as we lay down our lives for one another. We ask for your help to fulfill this covenant, Father God, that we will be one, that we will be able to do what we're called to do, Father God, to further the kingdom, that we can have one on the north side of town, the south side of town, the east and the west, Father God, that we can spread across this town and infiltrate every area, Father God, with the gospel and have power, Father God, knowing that we always have a brother and sister to lean on, Father God. We praise you. We give you all honor and all glory. In Jesus' name, all God's people said, love on them, hug them, and thank you. We thank you for being patient this morning, for coming and blessing us. We ask that you come back Wednesday, bring a friend, bring an enemy, bring somebody. We'll see you then.